Welcome back to Callahan's Corner, where you ask the questions, we answer them live right here on Facebook. We're talking about all things credit cards and why it's essential for you to have a credit card on file for not one, but all of your clients that you are using, are doing work for in your service business, whether it's lawn care, home cleaning, pest control, and some other industries we're going to dive into. I've got a special guest today on Callahan's Corner. Traditionally, I'm just running solo, Mr. Chad Raines, all things workflow automations expert from the SimpleGrowth team. So, Chad, I want to welcome you to the Callahan's Corner episode today.
Well, thank you so much, Mike. I'm glad to be here. Sad to not have my bow tie on, though.
Well, a lot of these conferences are either getting delayed or going virtual. So I know everybody knows you as the bow tie guy when we are live at the booths. Such as SA6 last year, or Debbie Sardone's CBF, and not to mention Martha Woodward's QDS, quality-driven software. So obviously, a lot of times, some of these things are getting delayed now, so I want to bring you on and keep you in front of a lot of our fans and people that are watching. But the thing we're talking about today is, why is it important to have a credit card on file, and actually, how do you go out and actually get a credit card on file? So if anybody has prescribed to Jonathan Potoshnik of the Lawn Care Millionaire, Jonathan was first on the scene probably 6 or 7 years ago, talking about why it was essential to have a credit card on file before you do service for anybody in your service business. So the way Jonathan broke it down, something I learned probably 8 or 9 years ago, a lot of guys and girls in my masterminds group have adopted this as well. So I'm going to give you some best practice, and then Chad's going to break down how to systematically set this up in your business for success, so the ball doesn't get dropped, especially in the busy spring season, or maybe the fall and aeration over season that's coming up in the lawn care industry. Or as things start to pick back up here with COVID, if this is something you're doing in your cleaning business, you want to make sure these things are in place. So Chad's going to break that down for us in a minute. But I want to talk about the theory and the method of a credit card on file and why it is absolutely essential. Like I said, Jonathan of the Lawn Care Millionaire also owns probably a $10 million plus a year doing residential only landscape maintenance, mowing and fertilizing, and how that allowed him to scale exponentially. Something that we took into my company, Callahan's. And the idea is we go in and get a credit card on file for all the services. And what we did in our business as well as what Jonathan did is we went in and did all the work we did this week would get billed out on the following Tuesday. Now, there's two reasons. If there was some rain delay, there was some issues, it was consistent on the same day every week, they knew when their card was getting run. Second reason is if there was customer service issues, we didn't want to run the card that evening or the next day in case there was an issue that came up. It allowed us to go out and adjust and make sure that the product that our service teams provided was on point, and it created consistency for billing for the team to go in and sweep out and Z out those credit cards. And now if you're using a product like Service Autopilot in your accounting screen, you're literally going to have a bunch of empty check boxes. You're going to select all. They all go down. You literally hit charge the cards. A little button pops up. Are you sure you want to run all these cards? And then once you hit yes, it literally runs all the cards. So one of the biggest mistakes we made in my business is when we first instituted this, I was a little nervous, to be honest with you, and I think a lot of people are, and for good reason. We didn't jump in headfirst in the deep end. We said, we strongly recommend or require the card. If you're not going to do the card, we need prepayment a month in advance for those services. Then we got a little more bold and said, okay, even if you're prepaying a month in advance, we still need a credit card on file, because if you don't pay us, you're going to authorize us to run your card. And then for some of the other services, such as aeration and overseeding, if they didn't have a card on file, we required them to pay in full or a 50% deposit for like a mulch job or shrub trimming. What that did is it extremely helped cash flow. But since we didn't jump in head first and require the credit card 100% up front with basically no exceptions, is basically what we did eventually, is that became an issue, because Tammy in the office or Christine in the office, when they were doing the billing, it created an inconsistency. It wasn't a consistent process of workflow, and things got missed. And not necessarily their faults in the office by any means, but they got missed because we didn't have a standardized operating procedure, an SOP for billing, because we had 3/4 of the people on credit cards. We had other people with a card on file but wanted to pay a month in advance. And then we had people making deposits that didn't want to give us a credit card. So we've got three, maybe four different ways of billing go on. It started to create chaos and things got missed. So what I'm recommending is if you're going to do it, you do it 100%. And I will tell you, if you do it correctly through some several automated emails with a PCI compliant credit card form, which basically is going to create a tokenized process where that credit card number never hits the server of your software and goes to the credit card process, everything's secure there. And if we can't physically get that credit card from the automated forms and the emails, we create a process after the third or fourth attempt for somebody from your office to physically call out and reach out and get that card. Bless you, Chad, there. It is a springtime or midsummer allergy season here in the Northeast for sure. So what I'm going to suggest then is we go out 100% and we get those credit cards on file. We go through an automated process. And after the third or fourth attempt, it triggers a person to go in. Now, you may be asking, Mike, well, that sounds great, but maybe I'm selling 10, 15 jobs a day. How do I keep track of who has a card on file and doesn't have a card on file? Because it sounds like sometimes it doesn't happen immediately. Well, you're right. Sometimes it doesn't. That's why we built an automated process. But in addition to the automated process of getting the card on file, this is why I brought Chad on as our automation expert who builds and tests these things. To kind of break down on a high level, not necessarily in the weeds, but how do you go out and automate a process inside a software system to go out and allow the job to be scheduled? And then if and only if that card's on the file, can we actually do the job? So Chad, definitely the floor is yours on a high level. I think people have comments or questions on the live or recorded version. We'll keep an eye on this. But as far as the automation expert over here at SimpleGrowth, been with us several years. What would you think is best practice when somebody signs up and accepts the estimate either live or electronically on that form? That sets a process in play. What happens once the estimate or job is won?
So there are two major ways that you can approach this particular kind of problem. I think the first way, and this is, lots of allergies. Step one is don't have a process in place that's going to create confusion and chaos. So if you have an automated system, that can be through Service Autopilot, that can be through, I believe HubSpot has something similar, you're able to have the estimate be won, and then you immediately move into sending out an email with a form attached. If you can make the barrier of entry as low as possible, then your client will be able to go from I have accepted to actually moving into now I have a card on file. So that would be number one, is automate it so that as soon as they accept an estimate or they accept service, it allows the card to be sent out. Now, depending on your software, it might also be able to move from any time that an estimate gets accepted into only if the client does not have a card on file. So that way, as you start to do upsells, as you start to move into any kind of sales campaign that you're performing, you're not going to be sending out the same email that you've already sent out before. So that's number one. Number two, and this is also quite useful, is go ahead and once they have accepted, even if they don't have a card on file yet, go ahead and schedule the service inside of your CRM. And then pause the service so that way you're never having a moment where someone is trying to figure out whether or not an estimate is live or if it was canceled for some reason. Go ahead, do that, pause it. And if you can, make a note of why it was paused and when, obviously. Service Autopilot does that automatically. And I believe, again, other CRMs have a timeline note feature, so you're able to have that information. But you're able to move from saying, we're waiting for a credit card, we don't need to schedule this, to we've scheduled this, we're not going to perform the service until the card is on file. So those are the two major ways that I think are going to be of use.
Awesome. So if I'm understanding you right, Chad, we've basically how we broke it down at SimpleGrowth and as well as my company before SimpleGrowth even existed is we adhere to life cycle marketing. So we want to talk to the client where they're at in the life cycle. So if they become a new client, whether it's a one-time or recurring service, it doesn't necessarily matter. That's going to trigger an automation, such as we have in Service Autopilot, to get that credit card on file, the PCI compliant form. At that point, we're recommending at Simple Growth, far as the best workflow that Chad's talking about, is now that that, say, lawn mowing or weekly cleaning has been one, we're going to schedule it but pause it. And then the third and final step is an automation will trigger inside Service Autopilot in the automation to assign a to-do and probably an email. That to-do is going to have a deadline with pretty specific instructions saying, hey, this credit card has been received through the form. It's now in the system. We have a way to bill them somewhat automatically. At this point, unpause the service and get them going. And he also mentioned putting some notes in there, which I think is huge, because if you have a multi-person office, they may go in and say, why is this paused? Is it a credit card that we need on file? Is it they've signed up, but they don't want service till next month, actually, till they move into the new house? What are those things there? So one of the biggest things that I've seen in our business here at Simple Growth, as well as my lawn care company, is a to-do or a pause or a cancel isn't complete unless there actually is documentation on it. So it didn't happen unless there was actual note or something written down on that as well. So Chad, I really appreciate you breaking that down for us in a systematic way and how to make sure we get the card on file, we schedule the service, but we pause it. So that way there's no way we ever go out and do it without that card on file. And then we have a to-do and an email usually with a deadline assigned to a specific person or a role, depending on the size of the business, for accountability to make sure that gets on the schedule with notes on it. Any other comments, questions before we wrap this up, Chad? I know this is something we've been doing for a while, but a lot of service businesses will run into significant cash flow problems. And this is not the end all be all to cash flow problems. But the key thing is, if I'm doing all my work this week and I bill it out Tuesday on a credit card the following Tuesday with the turnaround, such as a company like Clarent, you're going to have cash in the bank before you run your payroll on Friday. Now, obviously, we need to have ample cash flow and some reserves, especially with all the stuff that's going on. But this is a key way to keep cash flow king, especially in the spring season in a lawn care company where your overhead is significantly higher because everything's front-end loaded. So if you're looking ways to manage your cash flow and have liquidity, this is a great way of doing it. And worst case scenario is you're only going to be out one mowing or one cleaning. You're never going to let it stretch out over a whole month span. So it limits your risk and liability there. And last thing is, if you're also looking at cash flow management, a book that I highly recommend is Profit First by Mike Michalowicz. He also has Profit First Accountants that specialize in each industry. But the idea of Profit First is kind of seeing the ebbs and flows of your cash flow. It was instrumental in Simple Growth. When we adopted that from day one, but the ability to put your profit first and put that in a savings account, your distributions, and especially your taxes. And then you have the net operating liquid cash flow in your operating account. And it allows you to see where you're at. There's also some other accounts, but those are the basics of it. So Chad, any closing thoughts here? I really appreciate you coming on and dropping a knowledge bomb on us about some automations and how to do that.
Yeah, no, the biggest thing is that the incredible capacity to have the money for cash flow same week is so huge. So being able to bridge that gap and not being reliant on the on going to a bank and actually sending checks or having to play catch up with your clients is pretty huge. So I think it's an incredible motion forward. Biggest pitfall that you're going to face is people emailing you in their credit cards. So having a form, having something that is PCI compliant, that takes that stress completely out of the situation.
Yeah, and Chad, you bring up a good point in closing here is when you have an office staff, new or existing, when you start getting into credit card processing, you need to educate them that you do not take a credit card and write it down on a piece of paper. You do not put it in the client's notes. Everything needs to be in through a PCI compliant form or PCI compliant entry point like the have in Service Autopilot or many of the other software platforms. But once it hits it, it's tokenized. No one can go in there and see anything besides the last four digits in the expiration. That is going to keep your business safe. If you don't play by the rules as a business owner, you can get burnt. So we want to make sure that you are playing by the rules, just like we play by the rules with email marketing and CAM spam compliancy, something not to be messed with. So Chad, I appreciate it. Any other comments or questions on the live recorded version, put them in. Chad and I will be keeping an eye on this in the next 24 to 48 hours. And we'll see you again tomorrow. Callahan's Corner, you ask the questions, we answer them live right here on Facebook.